My name is Rick Boats. I'm a private practitioner in partnership with Medivet, which is a fairly large group in the UK, 170 surgeries, which is where I get most of my cases from. Now, my involvement in elbow replacement stems from the frustration that many of you have with what is currently available to treat medial compartmental disease. Like many of you, I had done all sorts of different things, including ulnar osteotomies, which have got unpredictable results, as you will know, less than satisfactory. Arthroscopy and arthrotomies, with and without subtotal coronoidectomies, which, in my opinion, merely treats the complication and not the problem. And the result of that is, as we heard earlier, that comebacks are very frequent. Sliding humeral osteotomies, which attempts to unload the medial compartment, with a significant amount of comebacks with non-unions and fractures and all of those things. Of course, the big one that caused a lot of controversy, Q, which attempts to resurface the medial compartment. And having done quite a large number of these, I could only report about 80% success, but have serious doubts about the long-term benefits and seeing more and more of these cases coming back. And of course, the underlying problem is not dealt with. As you just heard, Paul, which unloads the medial compartment, and having done way over 100 of these, I keep getting really good and predictable results. On the proviso, it is done correctly with the right patient selection, if it's done for the right reasons, and don't expect too much of a procedure which can't deliver everything. The problem with all of these techniques is that it is of no use where there is a collapse of the medial compartment. Where the medial compartment is collapsed, the medial articular surface is destroyed, and none of these other techniques will actually address those. And to address this problem, the techniques available today will just be that an elbow replacement is needed. But the elbow replacements that are available today are fairly complex. I've done the Tate, haven't had really good success with those. They are expensive to perform, really expensive to tool up for, and they have dramatically high complication rates even today. And what is needed is a technique which is reliable. You have to trust in its outcome. A technique which is repeatable, a technique that you can repeat over and over and over again and get good at, and a technique which is resilient, a technique that holds a promise that it will last. It will last the life of a dog. That's what is needed. A technique which is relatively simple to perform and which is affordable, both in tooling up for and actually asking the client to pay for it. In short, we need a technique that actually works. Now, I was granted the privilege to work with KYON to implement their hemiprosthesis, which is the partial replacement, and to work this into a viable option for elbow replacement in those 85% or more of cases where the medial compartment is destroyed, but the lateral compartment is perfectly viable. More than 85% of your elbow dysplasia cases will fall into this category. And the hemi system can be compared to the cupless hip replacement in that there is no ulnar compartment for the humeral implant to interact with. It relies instead on a humeral implant that rubs against the prepared bone surface of the ulna, a concept very well proven by the cupless hip replacement. Now, the hemi replacement's design is actually fairly basic. There's very few components in there. It is, as you can see there, basically just a disc positioned in the medial condyle, which interact with a reamed out surface in the ulna and held in place by a singular screw. And that's it. But rocket science is fairly basic. A simple design, well thought out, positioned in the medial, medial elbow with a relative simple operation and held in place by a simple screw. But its simple design belies the brilliance, in my opinion, of its innovation. And its simplicity, in my opinion, again, is its greatest strength. It allows for a reliable surgery because it's simple to insert. It allows for a repeatable surgery. He can do it over and over and over again because it is simple to put in. And because of its simplicity, I think it has got the promise to be resilient. It will endure. There are very few things that can break. Effectively, just one disc. The screw becoming redundant after a while. The core of the disc is a mesh, as many of the other implants are, which allows integration of the bone into the implant. And the surface of the disc is, again, a smooth metal, probably titanium, coated with the same black material as you see in the current head of the total hip replacement, as well as in the patella groove replacement implant. The technical details itself, I'm sure Slobodan and Steven can actually discuss with you. Now, fundamental to the success of the operation is the need to position the disc perpendicular to the rotational axis of the elbow. In short, it needs to be in the right position to work. If you put it in the wrong angle, it won't work. It needs to be perpendicular to the rotational axis of the elbow. And to achieve this critical step, you need to find the sagittal plane. And the sagittal plane is determined by anchoring the humerus by two screws into the proximal part of the humerus, and you're clamped in those pins onto a vertical support which is screwed into a base plate, as you can see there, the one with the holes there. And then you put the screw into the distal part of the radius, roughly perpendicular to the surface of the radius, and you flex the radius, sorry, you flex the ulna, and where that pin touches upon a vertical support, you make a mark. And then you flex the elbow, you extend the elbow, and you make another mark on another vertical support, which is screwed into the base plate. Now, between these two bars, then, two pins, then you bolt the bar. And that bar, which is then the line to the marks you've made, represents the sagittal plane. And that sagittal plane, that bar, becomes the basis of orientation for the whole surgery. That's the key to success to the surgery. It takes a little while to sort out, but if you've got that sagittal plane sorted, everything bolts up, onto that part of the preparation. Now, after this, the leg is anchored into the base plate by further pins, as you can see there, at the back of the ulna, and then they are screwed onto the vertical supports, and that basically stabilizes the whole leg in its right position. And the surgery can now commence. The flap of the medial condyle is removed by using a saw guide which slots into this over this vertical, onto this sagittal plane bar. And the depth of the cut of the medial condyle is determined by planning on your x-ray and dialing in what you plan onto the calibration on this, onto the saw guide. When you place the saw guide in the right position, you take off a medial flap at the right appointment. After that cut has been made, the medial flap is reflected cranially, and the high-speed burr is used to take the bone away to a depth of around about 6 millimeters, and that allows you to find the exact center of the intercondylar bridge. And that center can be seen as the center of the ring of the cortical bone of that intercondylar, intercondylar bridge at the narrowest point below the intercondylar foramen. And that center of that little bridge is also then the axis of rotation for the elbow. So you can see that it's right below the intercondylar foramen at the narrowest point, and the center of that would be the axis of rotation, which is determined by the sagittal plane, which you put the bar out and everything bolts from that part. Now, having found the center of rotation, you then put the drill guide, which again is orientated to this bar, and the pin is placed through the axis of rotation through to the lateral condyle. And this pin, which you drill into the lateral condyle, acts as a guide for the special reamer that is designed for this process. And the last 1 to 2 millimeters then is reamed out using the reamer over this pin in the center of the rotational axis. And then you place your little disc. You place back the lateral, so the medial flap. You secure that with an ALPS 902 plate. And that's it. It's not rocket science. It's easy. Even I can do it. That's probably why Slobodan asked me to do it. So I can do it, you can do it. Now, compared to the other elbow replacement techniques, it is relatively uncomplicated. And therefore, it is repeatable. The operation itself only lasts for about 1.5 hours. Preparation takes about 20 minutes. And you come to the end of the operation and you know everything is done correctly. It is really very simple to do. The question is, how well do these patients cope? Now, it is true that the patients with any elbow operation we go into the elbow is quite significantly lame. And absolutely, that's true with this procedure as well. But they progressively improve, so that around about 7 to 8 months, these patients have got normal use of their legs again. And here, I think, is the key benefit to the KYON's elbow replacement system. These patients seem to get back normal use of their leg, including normal rotation of the foot. Having done other elbow replacement techniques, I know that all of those are basically hinges, not really allowing proper rotation of the foot. And that, that leads to abnormal movement of the leg and the failure of the implants. That's the reason why there's so many failures. Because the dogs have to put stresses on the implants, which the implants can't cope with. But not so with the KYON system. This is the key benefit. And combined with this key benefit, with the simplicity of its design and the relatively straightforward surgical technique, leads me to believe that what has been achieved through KYON's medial replacement system is for the elbow what the total hip replacement was for the hip. And here are some of our results. And what I've done was to cluster the surgeries together in order to follow these cases side by side. So I've done a few of these clumped together so that I can see how the patients cope week by week and make it easy for me to follow. Now, I chose a variety of ages. Some of these patients were very young, and some were very old. The first of these, a little staffy, 9 years old, and you can see this dog is seriously lame. I don't know guesses which leg is the worst. Now, this dog had hip dysplasia, and the other elbow is also sore, but it's very obvious this dog's right leg is in agony. Pre-op x-rays. No first prize there to tell me what's wrong there. I mean, that elbow is shot. This will not be a case for a pole surgery. Your pole is going to fail. No doubt about it. From a cradle-caudal view, you can see that medial compartment is gone. It's collapsed. If you do a pole, you're going to fail. That is not the surgery for these cases. After the surgery, this is my, I think it was my second one I've done. There's a lot to say about what not to do, I can say that. But you can see it's a fairly easy placement of the disc. The ALPS plate I can criticize myself with, that is way too short, the ALPS plate. You'll see in the later ones, it is, doesn't look as bad as this one, but it worked. Cradle-caudal, you can see again, the disc, single screw. Now, if you look at on the side, on the right side of the slide, there are two little small screws there. The approach, the medial approach, requires a taking off of a small section of the olecranon to gain access to the medial condyle, and I replaced that by using two small 2.4 self-tapping screws. This is the same dog, of course, 5 months post-surgery. Now you can see this dog is still fairly lame. If you turn to the side, you can see there the gait is still pretty abnormal, but it's significantly improved from pre-surgery. Same dog, 8 months later. Now in my books, that's a pretty outcome for a dog of 9 years, at that stage already 10 years old, with all the other arthritis and looking at the severe state of his elbow x-rays before surgery. The next dog was a two-year-old Labrador. Unfortunately, my video file got corrupted for his pre-op video, so I haven't got it, but he was significantly lame. 2 year old, looking with elbows looking like this, I mean, that is not good. That is not good at all. Let me just see the lateral one again. If you look at that lateral view, you can see the osteophytes and the corneal process there, the sclerosis of the bone. Again, I don't think that is the case you're going to choose for your pole surgery. This, in my view, in my experience, bodes for a bad outcome if you choose this case for a pole. Cradle-caudal, okay. You can see again significant changes to that elbow. Post-surgery, is this thing moving up now? Okay, let's see there. So lateral, you can see I changed the plate going behind the intercondylar screw with I think it was ALPS 9. And the cradle-caudal view, you can see the good contact between the disc on the lateral side as well as on the medial side. And again, you can see the small little screws there where I've reattached the small fragment of the olecranon back with the self-tapping screws. This is this dog at 5 months post-op, and again, well, you didn't see the pre-op video, but this dog has improved, although at 5 months, this dog is still pretty lame. But at 8 months, now this is a happy puppy. You can see that dog is really happy. And look at this dog when he turns. He's turning on that leg with the weight on the leg. He's rotating that leg, and there's no strain, no excessive strain. He's behaving like a normal dog. And that, I think that's the key to the surgery. Fairly straightforward. This dog is turning. Next case. This dog was shaved the day before surgery. This dog is, as you can see, seriously lame. Pre-op photos, lateral. Not as much the osteophytes visible in the anconial process, but look behind the radius and look at the radial head. Sorry, behind the medial condyle and look at the radial head and the sclerosis. This dog, though, on the next view, on the caudal view, I mean, that's a total collapse of that medial compartment. Post-op views, again, ALPS plate behind now. Works pretty well. And force is slightly skewed, but again, just a straightforward disc. And then this dog, 5 months post-op. Slight lameness, not a lot of lameness visible there, but still slight lameness. And at 8 months post-op, looking like a much happier puppy. Can you see how consistent the recovery of these dogs are? And all of my cases are the same. Consistently at around 5 months, this dog is functional. Consistently at around 8 months, this dog is back to normal. Consistently, we see that patients able to rotate that foot. And for me as a private practitioner, consistently the clients are over the moon with the results. Now, a few questions you may ask. Is a single screw enough to secure the implant? Yeah, this partial replacement is reamed in such a way that it is supported by the bone proximal to it, as that red arrow will indicate there. And the integration of the bone into the implant is so well that after a few months, you can take a screw out. It's not needed anymore. It is such a good integration that we had no screw breakage at all, no screw back out or anything like that. The integration of the bone to the implant is so good that a complete stability of the implant can be expected for the life of this patient. What about implant rotation around that screw? Because ultimately it's just a single screw and the round little disc, can it rotate over that part? And yes, we had such a case. And frankly, it was my fault because I didn't ensure that my transcortical screw was, intercondylar screw was long enough to engage properly with the lateral condyle, and I didn't get enough compression, and that allowed the disc to rotate. Corrected that, disc was compressed properly, and problem solved. Dog is perfectly back to normal. Within 8 months, again, this dog was as normal can be. And KYON also then redesigned the implant with this complication in mind and put three spikes on the medial surface of the implant to bite into the sponge bone and also gives a bit of extra stability there. Personally, I don't think it's needed, because the one complication was my own mistake. It was not the fault of a disc. You also, of course, have to be very careful not to over-ream and allow the implant to sit too deep, because that will prevent proper compression of the implant. Have we done enough of these operations to iron out all the niggles? Well, we've done 12 of these by now, and another 5 are due later on in April. And that is not nearly enough to say that we've ironed out all possible complications. But the simplicity of its design and the simplicity of the operation itself gives me the confidence to say that very few things can go wrong. The more things you put into a joint, the more things can go wrong. Put one thing in, one thing can go wrong. Simple. So difficult to figure that one out. but you need to have patience. You have to inform your client from the start, this dog will be lame for a significant amount of time. And you have to take that journey with the client and walk them through. The client needs to be prepared, and if they are prepared for a slow recovery, this dog can expect a normal life beyond that. What age would I do this operation? Isn't the elbow replacement just as a salvage operation for the older patient? Now, you will know as well as I do that elbow dysplasia is sometimes seen in very young dogs, and some of these are pretty badly damaged. And my question to you is, well, okay, you've got a point. Something can go wrong in the life of a dog. But what else is available? There's nothing else available today that can give consistently good results that leads to a dog having a normal life. And just because there is a risk of implant failing in the same way that the hip replacement can fail if you put in a young dog, are you going to condemn a dog to a life of pain just because you're scared to put in a simple implant? What about when things go seriously wrong, like infections, for example? Now, well, that would be a serious and a troubling complication. But I do think this is a reason why the clients need to be informed. The client needs to make an informed decision. Knowing that things go seriously wrong, there will be serious complications, serious consequences. The client needs to be informed, and if the client can make an informed decision, then I'm happy to go with this patient. Now, I can say this. When a dog's coming like this, and they go home like this, for me, that's a no-brainer. So I would recommend this operation without any doubt. Its design allows for a reliable, a repeatable, and in my opinion, for a resilient surgery. It is a no-brainer. Just go for it.